Hey, what's up, guys? So today I have an awesome interview with V. Garrett Scott. He's basically building a mini boring company. It's a network of underground pipes that can instantly deliver packages within a city. He's calling it Pipe Dream. It's a super cool hard tech startup, super futuristic. It's the closest thing that anybody's trying to build that's close to teleportation. And I'm really excited to share it with you guys. So check it out and let me know what you think.
Dude, Garrett, good to have you on, man.
Yeah, thanks, man. I'm super excited.
Yeah, thanks for taking the time. So thank you actually for taking the time to crawl out from underground, which is where your Twitter bio says. I love that. But you actually didn't start with underground logistics. So Pipe Dream is for underground, but you didn't start there. That wasn't your vision. I was reading about how you came to this, and you started from how can we get to teleportation, right? And yeah. Then you coined the term hyperlogistics. So can you tell me how you came up with Pipe Dream and kind of how you worked backwards from teleportation?
Yeah, absolutely. So I was just kind of doing startups out of college. Just, I taught myself how to code, loved doing little SaaS things. And then a company that I was consulting for R&D asked me to come full time to manage a pivot and run biz dev for them. And I was like, I don't know if I'm a full-time employee kind of guy, but I took it. I was like, okay, I want to take it. Let's go 2 years and incubate myself and just focus on what industry am I best positioned to get into early that's going to explode over the next few decades, and then just live there for as long as I can. And so took the full-time job, was looking at different industries and realized logistics is holding back the types of businesses you can build so much. That is where the most change is needed, and there's not change happening. So we started thinking about it. We're like, okay, what's the end state of logistics? Teleportation. Once you have teleportation, logistics is solved, instant distribution everywhere. But what's something on this side of teleportation that if you could accomplish that, teleportation becomes less interesting, but is still possible with the tools we have around us today? Mm-hmm. And that's what we call the hyperlogistics. And to use an internet analogy, we're kind of at the point of delivery that we were with the internet where remember, I don't know if everyone remembers, you used to could download a movie, but it would take 6 hours to download from yeah. the internet. And so you would only do it as a special occasion, only if that was your only option. And then you would save that movie on your hard drive because you never know when you're going to need to download it again. So mm-hmm. you're managing all these files on your computer, you're servicing them on the computer, and you're keeping everything in your local storage out of convenience. But with the internet, when you're able to download really quickly, and then also just as frictionlessly upload really quickly back to the network, you didn't have to store as much on your local computer. And your local computer was just where you handled things and managed things, but everything else happened in the cloud. And instead of buying a $30 movie, we buy Netflix and we rent movies and we use just when we need them. And they're only on our computer just when we're watching them. That's the world that we see in hyperlogistics. When you're able to upload back into the logistics network and download really quickly, all these tools and consumables that you have in your home out of convenience for local storage, that can move into the cloud, the things cloud is what we call it. And so for instance, we all have a screwdriver probably, and we use it 5 times a year. And we only own a screwdriver because we need it. When we need it right away. So we have it out of convenience. If we were able to move to hyperlogistics, you wouldn't own a screwdriver. You would just tell Alexa, hey, I need a screwdriver. A really high quality screwdriver would show up at your house in about the time it takes for you to go to your toolbox and find it. You would use it and you'd put it back in this, this magic box, and it go away. And the amount that you spent on that transaction would be nominal, very small. And if you think about screwdrivers as an example, of what this means for atoms, hyperlogistics means that the world maybe has 10 billion, 15 billion screwdrivers, mm-hmm. Somewhere there. The world probably only needs 2 million screwdrivers properly distributed. So, their use time is a lot higher. So hyperlogistics means the world has less screwdrivers, so less resources spent on screwdrivers. Those screwdrivers made can be higher quality because they have a higher value and they'll make more in their lifetime. And people don't have to spend as much of their money on screwdrivers. And that across all sectors, we think is where the most potential is for this platform shift. And we realized if we could do anything to make that world possible this decade, it's almost, we almost can't afford not to try.
Yeah, for sure. This is like super important to reduce the number of materials, right? Needed to, yeah. to produce all the screwdrivers in the world.
Yeah.
yeah. So when we were talking last time, I think you were kind of just getting started with Pipedream and everything's really progressed. How are you going about building out this system? So I think I kind of jumped into it with the hyperlogistics, but what exactly are you building to do hyperlogistics? Like, just because not everybody's aware. So how are you going to satisfy hyperlogistics?
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, the goal of hyperlogistics is you just need a really frictionless, really fast, where's the thing stored to into someone's home. And we initially thought, okay, that's probably going to be drones. And my co-founder, Drew, awesome dude, super smart. He has his master's in aerospace, particularly unmanned systems. And we had done a drone project before, but what we realized is that there are some speed and usability problems with that as the only solution, as a daily driver, so to speak, to hyperlogistics. And realized that really for this to work, you need dedicated city channels for really fast ground transportation, just because of energy efficiencies and top speed potentials. And so we were thinking of this idea of like these covered channels in a city, and then realized even with today's technology, it made sense to, instead of having those above ground, to put those underground. And then, you know, we also took a little bit of a bet that there would be some emergent tunnel technologies that would make things, putting things in the ground, an order of magnitude cheaper. And just this week, that's come true. We found a great partner. I can't talk about them, but we have reduced our construction costs by 90%. Nice. But the goal here is build these dedicated city channels for really fast, frictionless underground delivery, and then eventually connect businesses and homes. So when you need an apple from the grocery store, the grocery store takes the apple, puts it in something similar to those bank kiosks with the tubes. It goes underground at 200 miles an hour, right into your kitchen, out from under the ground, and then you grab your apple.
So when you say construction costs, and it's you reduce it by 90%, are you constructing like pipes and building the underground yourself? Or are you contracting that out? Like, is that what your new partnership is? And like, are you mainly focusing on the tunnels and the machinery that you're building, like within the tunnels, the pods, or what would you even call those?
Yeah, we call them pods. And then there's a couple other systems in there. But yeah, the goal of this is to make this work, because it's a high infrastructure cost. The only way this works is if you can keep the infrastructure cost as low as possible and make it as easy to install as possible. And I think that's why cars beat trains, because trains are great, but they need really expensive, dedicated infrastructure. Whereas cars just need a flat surface. So the goal is, you know, you need to keep the infrastructure cost really low, so that you can put that in place and then scale the more expensive part per unit cost as the network scales. So let's see. I don't think I have a prototype. I can grab one at the end. I'll send you a picture.
If you want to take time to do it, that's totally fine. Hey, you can send me a photo too.
Yeah, I can send you a photo. Mm-hmm. And so the pods themselves are, imagine an electric car, but as a cylinder. So it has three wheels in a triangle. And then that's what's propelling it through ordinary PVC pipe.
Wheels and a triangle? Is the triangle for aerodynamics within the pipe? How did you come to that design?
Yeah. So it gives you maximum stability with the least amount of wheels. So yeah, we thought about maybe doing two wheels in line with each other, but not enough horizontal stability.
Oh, okay. So triangle. And then is the point forward? And then it kind of like bumps in, because I remember, does it bump into other things when it's within the pipes? I kind of want to get into the details of like how it works in the pipes, like, because I'm curious. I don't understand.
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, they run in trains. So you have, we have all the pods that are holding the packages, and those can go in slower speeds. We're targeting like 30, 40 miles an hour. But then in the high speed channels, we actually have other pods that those are the power to the system. So they don't have any packages inside of them. Their whole goal is to push a train of pods as fast as possible. So they do link in the high speed channels. And then the pods themselves, you know, you think of this as like a highway and an off-ramp situation, where on the highway, they're linked with the mules, pushing a group of them. And then the pods self-route out when they need to.
Okay. So are you going to first build like a circle around a city, essentially like a ring around a city, and then you can do the delivery with drones for the last mile?
That's 100% it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Imagine a subway system for packages.
Okay. Okay. So yeah, that's really cool. I mean, I really like that design because you don't want to compete with the drones, right?
No.
Not at this point.
Yeah. Yeah. Drones are going to own the next decade. They're amazing technology, and the FAA hopefully starts being more relaxed this year. Seems like they are. So hopefully we'll get drones ASAP. Yeah.
So how long did it take you to come up with the circle around the city kind of idea versus other ideas? Like what other ideas were you toying with?
It took us a little bit. You know, we were kind of resolute in the fact that if you're going to build a new city, you want to build it with this like alternate utility, essentially. And we were pretty resolute in that, but most deliveries happen in cities that are already built. So what can you do with anything? Can you put in that would help make city logistics more efficient for a cost that is reasonable for a city? Like what's the smallest amount of pipe you can put in that can have the highest impact? And so that's when we devised, we call it the portal system. Internally, we call it the loop, but then we realized Elon already stole that awesome name.
He's coined the loop for like hyperloops around cities.
Yeah, for Boring Company. It's a killer name. I mean, hats off to Elon. Uh-huh. It's the best thing to call it. We still call it that internally, but the goal of the portal system is if you are a Chinese restaurant and you are, you know, 700 feet from one of our portals, you take all your orders for the next 10 minutes, you put them all in that portal, they get self-routed to the neighborhood that they're going. And then the drones or the sidewalk robots handle the last mile from there.
Do you eventually want to do last mile, or like, are you just going to let the drones continue taking care of that?
Yeah, I think where it makes sense. I mean, I think we start with this system and then we'll have the math and the data to know where a direct connection makes the most sense. And I think the direct connection makes the most sense on the entry point to the system. So when you have these businesses who are doing high volume deliveries, that's where you save the most in a frictionless connection. And then I think for the last mile, I think it's going to be up to the math. But I think intuitively, you know, you build new infrastructure with this in place, but maybe not to every home in old buildings. So we'll have to see what the math says.
Yeah, I mean, I love this idea and I love the name. You came up with Pipe Dream. Like, just how did you come up with the name? Like, why did you name it that?
Yeah. I don't know. It's just like a shower thing. You like, I love like running like future simulations, as nerdy as it sounds. Like, okay, let's say this is super successful. Like, what's it going to be like? And I realized like, someone was going to find the pun pipe dream and be like, this is a pipe dream. And then that would be the headline. And that's what people say. So I figured let's just take the power away from them and just like own the craziness and like name it Pipe Dream. I also just think it's like, I love doing things that have like guaranteed success if you can make it work, but are super hard to get there. Those kind of like pipe dream projects. And I don't know, it worked.
So when you've been raising, like when you talk to VCs, has it been hard to convince them that like this pipe dream is feasible, or how have those conversations been going?
Yeah, you know, it's pretty easy. I don't really try to sell pipe dream at first. Mm-hmm. My whole goal is to kind of stress test this idea of hyperlogistics. And like, are we united? Like I kind of tell them like, here's where we see logistics going, here's the opportunity. And then I can usually convince them that hyperlogistics is gonna be a thing. And now the question is, you know, 10, 15 years from now, it's 100% going to be a thing. Can we cheat that timeline and make it quicker? That's the next thing that either I have to convince them or they may get it intuitively. So if me and a VC can agree on hyperlogistics as the future, then Pipe Dream makes a lot of sense. And I just had a great call right before this with a VC. It was like a 10-minute call, but like as soon as he got hyperlogistics, he's like, oh, well, this makes total sense. Absolutely. So it really depends on the VCs. And we kind of steer away from the ones we tend to like the higher conviction VCs who think about, you know, emergent industries. Yeah. Those are the ones that are more receptive.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I had just heard that like on Twitter, you had connected with a few VCs that like immediately understood and had been like looking for these kind of systems. So that was kind of why I was asking that, like that VCs had been waiting for you to start building this. That's really
cool. Yeah. A few of them for sure. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Twitter's like super important.
Yeah.
As like a new startup founder. Twitter's like super important, right?
As Twitter's the most important. Founder. Yeah. Twitter's been paramount to any success we've had. And if I was even thinking about building a company within the next year or two, I would start Twitter immediately.
Absolutely. Yeah. So like, what stage is the vehicle in right now? What have you built?
Yeah. So what we're working on right now is just confirming as many hypotheses as possible. And, you know, we built this prototype system. Our first prototype was fully 3D printed, and we were so excited about that. And then when something didn't work, we realized, oh, well, now we got to redesign the whole thing. So the team did a great thing. They built this system based on Rails. So it's kind of like 80-20 for our design, where every subcomponent locks into the Rails. And you can, as we redesign subcomponents, we can switch out from the body. So that's going to be really great for testing. And yeah, that's the stage that we're at in the engineering side is just making sure that all the things we thought intuitively or that work in a simulation, let's make sure that they work in real life.
Have other people tried to build this before?
Yeah. So New York tried to do it with pneumatic tubes. So the way that pneumatic tubes work is like you have vacuum on one side, you have air pressure on the other side, and then the air pressure pushes the pod down the tube because of that. And that did not work. And that was in like the 20s. It was a long time ago. So I think those tubes are still there under New York. They did a little bit in Chicago and a bunch in Berlin. And the reason that didn't work is because one, it was high infrastructure costs, like really high, because it's a lot of machinery to put underground. And
machinery for making it a vacuum, so it's pneumatic?
Yeah, making the vacuum system. And the problem with relying on the vacuum system is once one part of the section broke and it wasn't holding air anymore, that whole neighborhood was down. And they had to dig up the streets to go in and fix it.
No way. They didn't have an access point. They had to redig up streets.
Yeah. Yeah, because if it breaks, if you have an access point, it needs to break at the access point to be helpful. Mm-hmm. So they abandoned that for horse and buggy. And then it may have been tried since. There is a new company with SpaceX engineers who are working on something similar. They're looking at in between cities out in the UK, I think.
Okay, so like a little bit bigger.
Yeah, I don't want to pitch their business for them, but I think it's like a meter and a half.
Okay. So what are you gonna do when something breaks down in between? Are you gonna have to dig it back up, or is it because it's sewage? Like you're using sewage PVC pipes, right?
Yeah.
So you're doing that, is it like easier to dig it and pick it and fix it?
Yeah, I'll be completely honest. Like until this happens, it's going to be a thesis. Like, you know, but the plan is that's big enough to put in maintenance robots. And, you know, the system's pretty light, so it can only break in two ways. Either one of the pods breaks down and you have a cleanup crew go extract it, or the PVC wears out. And our thesis right now is that you can have a pretty simple machine that has extra PVC in it and can fix it kind of like a 3D printer builds things. So you melt it down,
so you can like print it on. Okay.
Yeah. And if it's fractured, bring it back together and go ahead and stitch it up.
That's actually pretty sci-fi, like having little robots go fix your PVC in the underground networks.
Yeah. And you know what? We stand on the shoulders of giants. Like a lot of this tech has been figured out by gas pipeline people. So we're kind of just taking those discoveries and technologies and just trying to apply it down to a little smaller size and in plastic pipes.
Do you read a lot of sci-fi? This is like a left
field question. But yeah, I did. I did before I started this.
Now you have no time.
I need to read more. Yeah.
Have you talked to like the military about this? Because this seems to have military applications by drilling underground.
I think I can talk about it. Yeah. Yeah. So we've met with DARPA has a program called the Underminer program. And the goal of that is, can we build really fast networks underground for in between bases, you know, finding people who are in deployment and running routes in between a main base and them. And so they're looking at the tunneling side, but what we've met with them about is like, once you have the tunnels built, what's the quickest way to, you know, create that good superhighway? So that's where we're excited. Hopefully we can work with DARPA on that. I think that'll be super awesome.
I'm still getting used to doing podcasts. So like I'm still learning. So I feel like I'm kind of jumping around a little bit.
I thought you've been doing amazing, man. This has been really good.
Well, let me know. Like, so I'm trying to think of like other questions that we should talk about right now. Like, so what other like interesting people have you been talking to throughout this? Because this is like a new type of business. You must be talking to weird corners of expertise. Like, who have you been talking to?
As many as people as who will answer me. Yeah, like our goal here is, I think the tough thing when you're doing something that is potentially paradigm shifting, is you have to balance talking to people who are really optimistic about the future and people who are really pessimistic about the future. Because people really optimistic about the future are going to help you find all the ways it's going to work, but they're not going to help you find the reasons it won't, because they're inherently optimistic. And it's great. Like, I love people like you. You're a future optimist.
Do you think you're optimistic or
no? Oh my gosh. 100%. 100%. To a fault. But like the goal of our team, and I think my co-founder balances out. He's really good at like breaking things down into
pessimism.
testable. What's that?
Pessimism.
Yeah.
into failure points.
Yeah, into failure points. Like, yeah, let's figure out why this is going to work. And so that's been the balance. So I've talked to, I didn't realize this was a thing, but logistics professors apparently are a thing all over, looking to find distress points. Like, let's make sure, like, you know, our goal is like hyper logistics is a truth. It's like computers. Like, all the materials to build a thinking machine existed on Earth, and we just had to discover enough of them to put them together to make a thinking machine. And we think hyperlogistics has the same truth that is waiting to be discovered. And as long as we're mission focused on making it happen and intellectually honest and humble enough to admit when we're not going the right direction, we're going to find it. And that's our goal. And, you know, I think that's why like Twitter's been amazing. And we've even thought about like building a Reddit community and stuff like that. Like, we just want to put as much talent and smart minds on this as possible. And our thesis is if we get enough smart people thinking about this, we can't fail.
Totally. That's beautiful. Yeah. I love that. What's the part that kind of concerns you? Like, what are you struggling with right now?
Oh man. I think the part that I am struggling with the most, and like, if you know me, I'm super confident that I can do most things. And it's like, maybe a bad quality, but we try to be like very aware of like where's our team naive. And I think, you know, things have been going okay with cities, but I think that's somewhere we just don't have like enough hours in that to know if that is going well. So that's something that concerns me. Are cities going to be as open to this as we think? That's potentially a thesis that could break and hurt us. Are we too early? You know, is delivery matured enough to accept us? Is, you know, are we wrong about our math? That's something that hopefully if we are, we'll find the failure point. But I think, you know, we're concerned about everything and optimistic about everything.
No, that's good. So it feels like with these kind of a pitch for, I don't know, business or cities is that you can actually build a lot of businesses on top of this platform. So if you have the platform of Pipes Underground, you can build businesses on top of that. What businesses have you been thinking about that can be built on top of this?
Oh my goodness. Yeah. So this is, if someone beats us to making hyperlogistics happen, we have an easy pivot into building one of these businesses. Like, I'm obsessed with hyperlogistics and kind of wish I could was born in a time where it existed. I'd build one of these businesses. I think Exact Ingredients is a killer business. If you could find a recipe and just hit Exact Ingredients and the onions come chopped, the spices come like in their correct proportions, you would have limitless access to eating whatever you wanted tonight. And you can make it quickly.
That'd be so nice.
Yeah, it'd be so nice. And cleanup is just putting it back in the magic box, you know? Tool subscriptions is great. I think clothing is a huge one. Just like, what do I want to wear today? Let's get it. And then when it's dirty, I put it back in and I don't own a washing machine or a dryer because that's not a service I need to handle myself. Like, I'm going to let the cloud handle like cleaning stuff.
I love that. I love how you think your dishes, like, you just put those back into the machine. You don't even want to own your dishes.
Yeah, it's so inefficient to, like, those appliances are so expensive and horrible at small scale. It's more efficient to run those in mass offsite.
So how many times another one that I'm so would use this? Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. My favorite one is the convergence of this in additive manufacturing means that almost anything is a digital file. Anything that anyone creates is a digital file, and it goes to a warehouse near you, gets printed with the best 3D printers in the world, the quickest 3D printers, and gets sent to you. So like your print time for that increases dramatically because you don't have to own the hardware. Someone else does. That's one that I'm super excited for.
So you can like link in with Duval's 3D metal printer.
Oh, yeah.
And then a Vucason, and then somebody can upload a CAD file. He 3D prints it and puts it into your pipes, and then it immediately goes to the customer's place. So yeah. Then that brings up the question, like, are you going to do cross-city transportation, or are you only going to be inner-city?
We think the most immediate value add is between a city, because it's still pretty efficient if you need to get goods from Dallas to San Diego. Batching it is still like an okay thing to do. It's still pretty quick. I think eventually, long term, we're looking at that. Just it'd be so cool. I mean, we've timed it, and you know, it'd be so cool if I could be in San Francisco and run an e-commerce business to anyone, and I can deliver in 3 hours to anywhere in the United States. Bananas. Wow. That'd be so cool. Like, but we think like the real value add is so much cost for your delivery items. And I don't want to say the percentage because I forget the exact number. A good amount goes into just figuring out the last mile. And most of the time is in the last mile. I don't know, like, if you've ever had something delivered and it gets to your city, and then it's just like, well, can't you just get it?
It takes forever. Yeah. But then, so essentially, so some 18-wheeler will come into the city, deposit it, and then it'll go on the pipes, and then it'll go to your drop-off location, and then a drone will take it the last little bit. So that way the drones don't have to go from the logistics station all the way to the homes.
Right.
In the beginning.
Yeah, totally. Okay. Yeah.
Going back to the dishes, how many times do you think somebody would use this per day?
That's the big thing. So in a mature environment, we've clocked it at like 30, 35 on the high end. And it's weird to get to that number, but when you start counting interactions that you have with things, it gets up there. Like, especially people with kids. I don't know if we want kids to have access to a limitless catalog every single day of toys, but they could just get whatever toys. It definitely gets up there after a while.
Like, so are you thinking, so like dishes, laundry machines, what else is there? Like, I can't even imagine. I think, I guess brooms, maybe, like, just kind of list a few of the items.
Yeah. So we look for really any tools or consumables or objects. There's some exceptions. I think like more daily use items, where you're using it for a large majority of your day, like headphones, your phone, computer, stuff like that's probably good to own because your usage rate is so high. But anything where your usage rate is, you know, below 10%, that's really what we're targeting. So clothes, tools, any food, seasonal decorations. Look around here. I have a whole thing of electrical components here, all those. Yeah, and probably a lot of things I don't own because, you know, I'm saving up for it, or I don't have it. Yeah.
So your background is a mechanical engineer, and then you did sales with your previous startup, or what? How did your experience help you build this?
So mechanical engineering was huge, and then doing startups myself, I learned just like if you need a tool, just Google and don't stop until you've Googled for 30 minutes, and you'll probably find a free tool that lets you do it. So that was hugely helpful. So I kind of learned the basics of engineering and then like how to be scrappy and build MVPs really quickly over my startup years. And then the 2 years I was running M&A, and we were, so that's where I learned like, okay, partnership is a little bit about the numbers and a lot about aligning expectations and values. I mean, if you can understand someone's expectations and their values and what they want out of a partnership, then partnerships are pretty easy. So that was huge. I'm so grateful they let a 25-year-old do M&A.
Yeah, that's awesome. Okay, so I want to talk about like your future vision, the massive vision here. Is it connecting the United States? Is it like connecting the world? Is there anything on Mars? Like, what's the layout, the massive vision of hyperlogistics?
Yeah, the massive vision of Pipe Dream is to make hyperlogistics possible. That's it. That's it. That's like all we care about. Pipes be darned, underground, robots be darned. Like, we will abandon that in a heartbeat if something else is better. The whole goal is to make, you know, the Internet of Things a possibility. So yeah, we really want to focus. We think it's like most broken in the last mile, but the goal is like, if I want to ship something, you know, from here to my grandma's house in Dallas, that should be a really frictionless, really fast experience. That's the goal, connect everything. And I think a lot of the problems with logistics right now lie in information, and it's not a protocol. And we think that eventually it's going to be a protocol. And I just say, I want this to my grandma's house, and I really don't know how it gets there. I don't have to like pick a service or like, you know, to bring things to the speed of the internet, there's going to take a lot of work, but we are here to do whatever we can to make it possible.
I love that. I love that, man. Do you think that there's anything else that I should have asked you or anything else that you want to plug?
No, you killed it, man. Dude, this is one of the best podcasts I've been on. This is amazing.
You're the optimist. Like, this is the best one.
Yeah, I would love to plug Pipe Dream. And if anyone listening to this wants to work on something like this, even if it's not pipes, you just want to work on hyperlogistics, I don't think there's a better place to be than Pipe Dream right now. Just, you'll have the biggest impact on the industry just because we're so small. And, you know, if you want to help in any way, I would love to talk to you. So find me at pipedreamlabs.co. Find me on Twitter, the Garrett Scott. Also, if you just want to meet me, this is a NASJAC exclusive. If you go to pipedreamlabs.co/schedule, that's my Calendly link, and you just throw time on my calendar. I'd love to meet.
Nice. Actually, you do this a lot. You help people build things in your free time, right?
Oh, yeah.
It's actually something that I think is really cool about every few weekends or so, you're like, hey, I'm going to do a build weekend and just work with people. I love that you do that. That's awesome.
Yeah, I love that people use it. And they're just like, trust me to help them. Cause I love that thing, that section where you take an idea to fruition. It's like addictive. And I love helping people, whether it be no code. I've spent a lot of time in no code.
Dude, I love no code.
Oh my gosh. You can build at this point in time, you can build anything you want in no code. And if someone disagrees with me, I would love to like challenge them to a build off. Yeah. So if anyone wants to take advantage of that, I'd love to hang out with you. It's GarrettBuildsFast.com. It just forwards to a Calendly link, and that'd be awesome.
Nice.
I've had so much fun with that.
Dude, that's awesome. What's like one of the coolest things you've built with that?
Oh man, I am so stoked for this one. It's like one of those that like at first you're like, I don't know, but like the vision that he has for it is bananas. So I don't want to pitch his business, but there is so much friction between helping people and like what you need. I am the worst at telling people what I need help on, but I know a lot of people who can help, and that there is a so much friction in between connecting people who can help and people who need help. And his thought process for connecting that is amazing. Let me shout out his Twitter real quick if anyone wants to
for sure
connect with them. I am really excited about that one.
So you guys, everybody listening needs to know that Twitter is the best place to be. Like, some people listening to this podcast will be from Twitter, but some of my audience like on TikTok doesn't have Twitter. And like, if you want to learn about startups, if you want to meet people building the future, if you want to get interested in futuristic tech or even just the memes about the future, like, Twitter is the place to be. It is the number one place. I am so glad I found Twitter. I am absurdly glad. Yeah. Like, I genuinely... Twitter has changed my life. Like, I don't know where I would be without Twitter. I do not know. Like, I don't think I would be doing NASJAC. Like, I don't think I would be investing in startups. Like, I mean, I'm so glad. Genuinely so glad that I found Twitter. And I would not know almost all of my friends. Like, a lot of my friends from university. Like, after university, you know, you graduate and you kind of like, I moved to like a new place. And like, I didn't have my university friends. And so I made now my new friends are online, and now I'm starting to actually meet them and live with them and stuff like this. So like, I love that.
Yes.
The power of Twitter.
What would you say for someone like that wants to get into tech, wants to get into startups, they download Twitter, what do they do next?
Who do they follow? They follow the Garrett Scott and Nasjack underscore underscore. They probably follow like Tremoth, Ramp Capital, just to like start with the memes, liquidity. Then, you know, they probably start also with Paul Graham, Naval, Naval. That's like, those are like the intro people. And then you kind of like disperse onwards. So maybe you find, then you find Jeff Lewis based on like Chamath posting a shirtless pic. And then Jeff Lewis is also the thirst trap VC. or you, you know, and then from Jeff Lewis, maybe you find like Paul Jokubin or Chris Liu. Like you just kind of go down that list. I've been meaning actually to make a few Twitter lists. So like hard tech founders is definitely one that I want to do. And then also like intro to startup Twitter. Is another list that I want to do. So I'll have a better idea of that soon. But I do think it kind of trickles down because like, for example, when I got interested in startups, I started by reading the Paul Graham essays, just like everybody else. And then, you know, going from the Paul Graham essays, maybe watching the videos on YouTube and then on Twitter and then who he talks to. And then from there, like who those people talk to, and it like, it curates over time. But yeah, go check out who I follow, I guess, is probably like a good start.
Yeah.
Because I recurated it. I unfollowed a bunch of people that weren't related to that.
Nice.
So, yeah, I used to follow like 1,600 people. And then now I follow like 600 or something. Yeah. Most of it was just from the beginning of Twitter when I was messing around. But yeah, totally. Who was the person that you were going to shout out?
Oh, let's see. Benschecter. Ben Schecter. Yeah, I love what he's building. Super cool.
So thank you for asking me about my startup list.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah. If you guys don't follow Nasjack on Twitter, I it's my favorite platform to follow Nasjack on. I think like your Twitter, your TikTok's great, but I think your Twitter is perfection. So
I know. Well, actually, so I did you see the meme that I posted today?
Yeah. It was amazing.
Virgin Jeff versus Chad Jeff after Jeff Bezos quit. Actually,
did you make that?
Yeah, I made that. Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't. It was so good. I thought you like got it from somewhere. That's amazing.
No, I was like drifting off to sleep last night, and it was midnight, so it was like too late to post. And it came to me, and I was like, oh, that's amazing! Like I have to make that. and then sadly, Chamath posted his shirtless pic, so it like everybody forgot about the pic. I was like, I still have to post this because I'm just so happy with it. But see, this is why you need me on Twitter, because the memes move fast. It's super fun. Yeah, totally.
Yeah, there's a whole meme economy to Twitter. If you can provide valuable memes, you are a valuable person on Twitter.
People have raised like VC rounds on memes. Like genuinely, 100%. Being a shit poster is like actually good for your career now.
Yeah, and the richest man in the world's core skill is shit posting. That's amazing.
Yeah, that's true. Well, I hear Elon has like people who like make memes for him, actually. Yeah, because his whole thing, I think he's like a master of narrative. And so his whole thing is that he wants to control that narrative, and he doesn't have time to make those memes, but like he probably has memes sent to him and he's like, no. Yes, that one's perfect.
That's amazing.
Like and it's like that Civil War meme. What was that one? Where I don't remember exactly, but
or the sea shanty one was top notch.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and so he probably like says no to 30 memes a day, and he's like, yes, I'll post that one. That one's good for my
Yeah, someday I hope he writes a book just on memes.
Oh my god. Oh my dude, I also want him to start interviewing more people.
The Vlad interview.
Oh my god. Oh my gosh. Amazing. Okay, did you take something away from that as like a CEO? Like, because his entire job is I mean, you know, he's kind of abstracted because he's so high up now, but his entire job is interviewing people and like extracting information and then making decisions based on that information. And like, he was amazing at that. What did you take away from that?
I'd love to hear what you took away from it, but I was just like, you got it.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, he kept it so simple and succinct. And when Vlad, the CEO of Robinhood, he brought him up to ask him about GameStop. And so Vlad started like, hi, I'm a Robinhood CEO. He's like, no one cares. Just tell us about the GameStop.
Yeah, we know you're the Robinhood CEO. That's why I brought you up here. Like everybody in this room is in Clubhouse, and that means you're already on startup stuff. So you already have like a level of understanding, and you're clearly still, dude, that was amazing because like he cut Vlad off and he was like, just stop your bullshit. give me the thing. And then he asks like a cutting question and then stop your, and then he gets more bullshit and he's like, stop it. He's like, bonk, the bonk thingy. And then extracts that information. No, I thought that was brilliant. And then like, when he asks a really hard question, he was okay with just letting the silence stay there. So that was the big thing. He was like, so were you selling trading data or whatever? And he just like lets it pause. And then Vlad's like clearly uncomfortable. And then he cut it with the joke, I think, at one point where he was like, is somebody holding a gun to you? But yeah, no, that was brilliant. I want him to see him interviewing more people. Actually, if people have more clips of him interviewing people, I looked around, but there's not many. Please like tweet at us to show us more clips of that.
Oh, that yeah. Amazing. I want to watch that while going to sleep. That was amazing. I hope Elon can interview himself one day. That's my ultimate dream.
That'd be beautiful. He does need to, well, I think I was going to say he needs to write an autobiography, but I also don't know how much I'd trust that autobiography.
Yeah,
it would definitely be fun. But yeah, he definitely needs to interview. I would like to actually see him interview Joe Rogan or somebody like that. Somebody big like that. I was disappointed that after he interviewed Vlad and Vlad kind of stepped away, I was disappointed that he didn't like start talking to Mark Andreessen or something, because that's actually an interview that I'd like to see. I would love to see Elon asking Mark questions and stuff like that. That'd be super fun. And there was actually, now I'm just kind of, there was actually a really good podcast where Mark Andreessen was asking questions to like this neuroscientist researcher. And it was like about just, I don't need to go into it, but like the way Mark asked questions too was like really fascinating. So I think that's just a really important skill as like a CEO in general. Just to learn how to interview and ask questions and have that.
Yeah.
So maybe I'll send you that podcast and you can check it out, and I'll put it in the show notes for everybody else.
Yeah. I think it definitely, like watching Elon do that, I was like, oh man, I'm not good at it. I need to get better.
Yes. Yeah. It's a big skill. Cool. So thank you for letting me derail the conversation. I actually really enjoyed derailing it, and I think that was excellent. So go follow The Garrett Scott on Twitter. Check out his Calendly link and subscribe to the podcast. If you're on YouTube, it's right below you. And go follow me on Twitter too, @NASJAC__. Anyways, man, thanks for the time, and I'll talk to you another time.
Yeah, absolute honor, man. I appreciate it.
Yeah. Oh, I'll see you in Austin soon. Actually.
Yeah, let's do it.
If you move there, that'd be super fun.
Yeah.
Awesome, man.
Absolutely.
Thanks for the time.
Yo, what's up, guys? Thank you for checking out the podcast. I sincerely appreciate it. I'm trying to grow the YouTube. I also post these videos or these audios on Spotify and Apple Podcasts and anywhere else you get your podcast. So check it out there. Leave a comment. Let me know what you think of Pipe Dream. I think it's really cool. It's like a mini boring company. And I can't wait to follow Garrett's journey in the future. So I'll see you guys in the next one. The next one is going to be with an awesome synthetic biologist. He's creating genetically modified organisms to enhance humans. So definitely subscribe for that, and I'll see you there.